America exists today because of the heroism and sacrifice which have been displayed by her sons on the field of battle. Time and again, generation after generation of Americans have proved their willingness to fight to preserve America, its people, their ideals, and their way of life. It takes many things to make a soldier. To make the kind of man who, when the chips are down, will prove himself a soldier. Patriotism. Courage. And above all, a sense of duty. America is only as great as the sense of duty in her citizens is strong. What that sense of duty is, where it comes from, what it means, are questions important to every American, and especially to members of the United States Army. This is Colonel Jack L. Treadwell. He's learned firsthand the value of a sense of duty.
I think that every American has a sense of duty, and I feel strongly that most men can be depended upon to help their country in time of great crisis. But what is difficult for many to accept is that there are duties in the Army which involve no great glory, but which have to be done. This situation has existed as long as there have been armies. It was certainly true when I came into the Army as a private in 1941. In fact, our situation then was similar in many ways to the one you're in right now. We had a peacetime Army in those days too. Peacetime because nobody was shooting at us. But there were places in the world where people were indicating that they might soon be willing to. It was a time when, for better than 20 years, dictators, totalitarians of one kind or another, had been taking over countries and organizing them for war. Faces and the countries were different, but the message was the same. The type of message America always hears from totalitarians. We are the greatest of the world's democratic nations, and because we are, we become the number one enemy of anyone trying to overthrow free institutions anywhere in the world. When America began building her military defenses, there was already a war going on both sides of the world. This wasn't our war yet, but there was plenty of reason to believe that it soon might be. And so we started trying to make up for lost time. Under these circumstances, it wasn't hard for an American to accept the idea that he might have to take a few years out of his private life for the service of his country.
What was more difficult for him to realize was that many activities and many seemingly unrelated things go into the training of a soldier. I don't mean the calisthenics, the obstacle courses, the close order drill. Anyone can see that these things are always necessary in the training of a soldier. What I do mean are those seemingly unrelated activities, polishing brass, the sweeping of floors, policing the area, and pulling KP. Yet these were a part of what had to be done. In civilian life, perhaps it could be left to someone else. But now it was a part of being a soldier, a part of Army life. A little less than a year after my friends and I came into the Army, Pearl Harbor was bombed, and America entered World War II.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. The United States was at peace with that nation, and at the solicitation of Japan, was still in conversation with its government and its emperor, looking toward the maintenance of peace in the Pacific. The attack yesterday on the Hawaiian Islands has caused severe damage to American naval and military forces. I regret to tell you that very many American lives have been lost. In addition, American ships have been reported torpedoed on the high seas between San Francisco and Honolulu. As Commander-in-Chief of the Army and Navy, I have directed that all measures be taken for our defense. But always will our whole nation remember the character of the onslaught against us. I believe that I interpret the will of the Congress and of the people when I assert that we will not only defend ourselves to the uttermost, but will make it very certain that this form of treachery shall never again endanger us. Hostilities exist. There is no blinking at the fact that our people, our territory, and our interests are in grave danger. With confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph, so help us God.
That was the beginning of the greatest war in American history. You might think that a soldier talking to other soldiers about a sense of duty would have a lot to say about what happens on a battlefield. There are two reasons why I am not doing that. First, I want to emphasize as strongly as I can that a man who hasn't learned to do his duty, who hasn't developed a sense of duty in the course of his training as a soldier, will fail to do his duty in combat when his own life and the lives of others may depend on him. On the other hand, the sense of duty that will make a man perform well in battle will generally show through in the less glamorous details of training. In other words, the sense of duty that may lead a man to distinguish himself under fire will have been built into his life when he did a good job policing the barracks. Not necessarily because he liked to, but because he recognized it as a duty. My second reason for not talking about moments of glory under fire can be demonstrated by a few scenes from the world we're living in.
As you can see, the faces change, the language changes, the flags are different. But it's the same old message. There are still men in the world dedicated to the destruction of free institutions anywhere and everywhere. In many places, their hostility has already flared into open combat. In Korea, American soldiers were fired upon in anger. We returned the fire and sent the aggressors back where they came from.
It can happen again, but this is not exactly my point. It is also possible that it won't happen again, simply because men like you are giving a part of your lives to the service of your country. By being where you are at this moment, you are contributing substantially to the job of making potential aggressors think twice before resorting to force. They will not start a war they have no hope of winning. We must remain strong and convince all our potential enemies that we have a sense of duty to our country and the preservation of freedom. The exercise of this sense of duty is not a one-way street. During your tour in the Army, you will face situations in which you can hold back, merely follow orders, and stay out of trouble. Nobody can compel you to do anything else, and no one will try. In other words, you can content yourself with doing the minimum, or you can accept your duty gladly, insist on the very best performance from yourself, thus take away from your military service habits of mind and body which will enrich your entire future. The Army and your country can show you where your duty lies. How well you perform that duty depends entirely on you.
This officer is himself a conspicuous example of what a man can do, both for his country and for himself, by exercising the sense of duty which should be present in us all. He has won not only the Medal of Honor, but every decoration which the Army can award the combat soldier. It is not given to every man to be thus summoned by his country's call to duty, nor within the power of every man so spectacularly to respond. But for every man, there is a need, a job to be done, according to his time, his place, his capacity. The test of a man is not what he is called upon to do, but how he does what duty tells him must be done.